The human brain is the most complex known structure in the universe. Along with the rest of our nervous system, it is responsible for everything we think and feel and gives rise to our personalities. But sometimes there are problems. Neurons can get damaged, causing ripple effects, or genetic and environmental phenomena could lead to cognitive or psychological disorders. All in all, these disturbances are, in one way or another, driven by interneural communication. But what if we could influence these communication patterns and connections? This is where neuromodulation comes into play. Hi, I'm Harrison Canning, and in this video, we will talk about neuromodulation, which enables us to influence our brain's functioning. The term neuromodulation may mean different things to different people. In general, the term itself refers to influencing or modulating neural activity. This process occurs naturally as neurons excite or inhibit each other, but it also can be stimulated artificially. Action potentials, the firing of neurons, can be generated artificially through pharmaceutical agents or neuroelectric stimulation. In either case, the objective is to excite or inhibit specific neurons, causing them to release neurotransmitters and kickstart a chain reaction. In this video, we are going to focus primarily on neuromodulation, which uses neuroelectric stimulation, as it relates most closely to the development of brain-computer interfaces. But before we do that, let's quickly take a look at pharmaceutical neuromodulation. Many drugs are neuromodulators, from pain medication to psychoactive drugs. These medications are influencing the firing of neurons in an attempt to provide relief to patients. However, as they are traditionally administered orally through inhalation or injection, their effects are widespread. This is like using a full body cast for a cut on your finger instead of a band-aid. According to the International Neuromodulation Society, or INS, neuromodulation devices work by either electrically stimulating nerves to produce a natural biological response, or by applying targeted pharmaceutical agents in tiny doses directly to the site of action. One of the hallmarks of neuromodulation is that these devices can target highly specific areas of the brain. Traditional pharmaceuticals can only grossly target neurons by the type of neurotransmitter they react to, which can create widespread adverse effects all over the body. The highly targeted nature of neuromodulation means that adverse effects can be minimized, and it opens the possibility to wider treatment options. Currently, these collective neuromodulation technologies are used to treat many forms of chronic pain, including headache, neuropathy, and complex regional pain. Neuromodulation can also help treat movement disorders such as spasticity, Parkinson's, tremors, and Tourette's, in addition to epilepsy, psychiatric disorders, functional brain restoration, cardiovascular disorders, and genitourinary disorders. There are also promising experimental results for addiction control and memory restoration with the use of brain-computer interfaces. We cannot possibly cover all of the technologies and ailments in the realm of neuromodulation, but we will provide links to resources provided by the INS's website for more information. The ability to stimulate neurons has wide applicability in both medical and non-medical applications. According to the INS, neuromodulation devices and treatments are life-changing. They can affect every area of the body and treat nearly every disease or symptom, from headaches to tremors to spinal cord damage. With such a broad therapeutic scope and significant ongoing improvements in biotechnology, it is not surprising that neuromodulation is poised as a major growth industry for the next decade. I can personally attest to the effectiveness of neuromodulation. When I was a teenager, I had near daily chronic migraines. I had tried dozens of medications and therapies without seeing much success. My doctor recommended that I join an experimental trial for a self-administered STMS neuromodulation device, and after a week, I had my first day without headaches in years. I used the devices as a preventative measure for several years, and now I am proud to report that I am largely headache-free and no longer need the device. But I am certainly not alone. Neuromodulation could help the 40 to 50 million people worldwide who have epilepsy. Could also help the 26 million migraine sufferers or the 250,000 people with spinal cord injuries in the United States alone. Neuromodulation is still well within its infancy, but already provides life-changing results for hundreds of thousands of patients with a wide variety of ailments. When neurotechnologists excitedly talk about the possibilities of curing all mental and brain disorders, they are generally referring to what could one day be possible with neuromodulation. Progress is being made in treatments for ADHD, depression, anxiety, Alzheimer's, and even autism. However, the jury is still out as to how and if these disorders could be cured. Neuroelectric stimulation devices inhibit or excite individual clusters of neurons by passing current through target areas via electrodes. In either case, the presence of electromagnetic energy induces current flow in the neurons by triggering an action potential. The effects can be quite localized or broad depending on the type of technology. Like other forms of neurotechnology, neuromodulation can be non-invasive or invasive. Deep brain stimulation, or DBS, is designed to send targeted impulses of electricity to specific structures deep within the brain and regulates abnormal functioning. It is commonly used for treating diseases such as Parkinson's, dystonia, epilepsy, essential tremor, and obsessive-compulsive disorder. DBS devices consist of an electrode, which is the point of stimulation, a lead, which is a rigid structure that is inserted into the brain, and an extension, which connects the lead to the pulse generator. The pulse generator sits outside the body over the pectoral muscle and can be programmed and charged externally. Thousands of lives have been changed with the help of DBS. Matthew, a DBS Medtronic ambassador, has had Parkinson's since he was 8 years old. 10 years ago, he received a DBS device, and it has made a huge difference in his life, saying, "There are a lot of things people would take for granted, but when you have Parkinson's, a lot of things can take forever, like making a drink, brushing your teeth, and getting dressed. But DBS has made it all so much easier." DBS enhances the quality of life of many patients. Like Matthew said, most people take for granted simple everyday tasks, but when you lose the ability to do these things for yourself, it is incredibly challenging to go through everyday life. DBS has shown time and time again that it can help people overcome these challenges and leave patients feeling independent and empowered. In spinal cord stimulation, an electrode stimulator is implanted into the spinal cord. The system is similar to the setup for DBS. It is used to treat many types of chronic pain. It works to inhibit signals before they are sent to the brain through electrical stimulation of target spinal areas. It is also useful in the treatment of irregular heartbeat, balance, and vascular disease. Nicole, another Medtronic ambassador, was told that she would never be able to run again after breaking her foot and starting a cycle of seemingly incurable chronic pain. After going through multiple surgeries, her pain did not subside, and her doctors were at a loss of what to do next. When they first activated the neurostimulation device at the doctor's office, she said that her pain had instantly vanished. In reflecting on her life since the spinal cord stimulation implant, she said, "I'm able to be the mom that I want to be for my kids, and I'm able to be the wife that I want to be for my husband. Now that my pain is under control, I'm running again." Transcranial direct current stimulation, or tDCS, utilizes direct electrical currents to stimulate the brain by delivering low levels of electricity via electrodes placed on the head. The electrodes can be used to stimulate either anodally, which stimulates neurons to fire, or cathodally, which inhibits neurons from firing. tDCS has shown potential in treating a variety of cognitive disorders such as depression, schizophrenia, aphasia, addiction, and chronic pain, just to name a few. Next, let's discuss stimulatory electrocorticography, or ECoG. Still primarily in the research phases, stimulatory ECoG works similarly to tDCS, but instead of being placed outside the skull, it is placed on the surface of the brain without penetrating brain tissue. This location means that you can apply more specificity to the stimulation. Early research shows that it may be effective in memory and speech restoration. The vagus nerve has been shown to be involved in many homeostatic functions such as digestion, heart rate, respiratory rate, and certain reflex actions. If any of these devices are not working properly, vagus nerve stimulation, or VNS, can come to the rescue. It is fitting that with so many functions, VNS devices take on many forms. They may be peripherally invasive or non-invasive and work to provide a vast array of treatments for depression, inflammation, metabolic syndrome, and certain types of epilepsy. Because of its wide potential uses, it is used as an experimental treatment for many new diseases, most recently the novel coronavirus. Transcranial magnetic stimulation, or TMS, is a non-invasive brain stimulation technique that uses electromagnetic fields to generate action potentials. Many forms of TMS have been developed. Some treatment requires the patient to make frequent visits to the doctor, which decrease over time, while others offer in-home solutions. The frequency, strength of stimulation, duration, and coil design can all be tweaked to change the effect of TMS based on the objective. Single coils have a very broad effect, and overlapping coils can reach increasingly smaller and deeper areas of the brain. Although still a relatively new technology, it has shown impressive effectiveness in the multitude of applications such as depression, bipolar depression, migraine, OCD, schizophrenia, and PTSD. Additionally, TMS is showing really positive research results in the treatment of motor neuron decay, increasing neuroplasticity, and executive functioning. Research presented at the 2020 New York City Neuromodulation Conference is investigating whether TMS could be used to counteract negative effects on the brain and nervous system in outer space. For every year an astronaut is in space, the ventricles, which are fluid-filled cavities in the brain, increase by 12% in volume, indicating a reduction in brain matter. Basically, the brain shrinks after long periods of time spent in space. This sometimes translates to slower executive functioning and decreased motor coordination when they land back on Earth. TMS could be useful for counteracting these effects for astronauts, but it may also be useful in treating motor neuron diseases. Experimental research indicates that it's possible for TMS devices to directly repair areas of the brain which have been damaged by traumatic events like strokes or concussions. All of these medical uses appear to be just the start of how we can use this technology to help people, and some researchers believe that neuromodulation could one day hold the key to curing multiple cognitive disorders. In this video, we talked about what neuromodulation is, its many forms, and explained how neuromodulation affects neural functioning. In the next video, Colin will talk about how these devices can be used for sensory substitution or cognitive enhancement.